So things you want to consider, I just want to go through several little things to think about when you're developing case report forms. Again, the protocol determines what data should be collected, and if it is documented or written on the case report form, it must be collected as specified in the protocol, and that data will not be analyzed. The data that will not be analyzed should not be asked for. I can't tell you how many times in the old days or early years of being a research nurse, we filled out humongous amounts of data, paper forms, case flow sheets with tiny little boxes where we had to fill in things. I found out years later much of that data was never used. Really very frustrating. Keep that in mind as you're thinking about what data you want to capture. Really, the CRAs at the other end, research nurses, really don't want to be capturing unnecessary information. It also adds extra burden to the patients as well, because you're collecting extra information that maybe they wouldn't be collecting otherwise. Other thoughts? Again, it involves, the development should involve various people from the research team. They all are involved in different aspects, so getting their input is important. Particularly the statistician and the programmer if you're going to be using electronic forms. Review the analysis plan. What's being asked for? That definitely will inform your CRF. And then look and see, are there previous forms you could model after or even replicate and use? So, again, what data is needed in relation to when the data will be available? Think about that. How many people are going to be involved in capturing that information? If you have some information that you need from perhaps the patient level or the patient chart level, but you also have other information that maybe you want to capture from a radiation oncologist, those are oftentimes two different areas within a research site. So maybe you want to develop two different forms, one for that patient-focused information and another form for the radiologist to complete. So it's all, one form isn't lost by it being information being obtained from another site. So things to be thinking about. And then again, who's going to be completing those forms? There are various degrees of expertise out there. Some CRAs and research nurses are very savvy. Others have not as much experience, so you want to think about that, especially what type of terminology you use and how you're capturing the information on the form. And I'll give you some ideas or suggestions on that as well. The data to be collected and the forms to be used should be clearly outlined, again, in the protocol. Oftentimes, protocol documents I'm used to have a specific section that describes what forms are due when, and also even a calendar of events that is a one-page form that people can refer to, and you're going to have more likelihood of getting the information back in a timely manner if that's utilized. Again, it should be clearly stated and self-explanatory, and it should hopefully correlate with your statistical software that you're utilizing. I said it again multiple ways. Generate friendly, user-friendly forms, thinking about your audience again. Avoid asking for lengthy text information. Try to get it in specific types, what information you specifically want. And again, collecting only essential and very important to number your keep track of what version you're using. Nothing worse than getting an old version into a protocol document and capturing the wrong information. Points that I found in a recent publication are to use consistent formats, font size, and style throughout the protocol and your CRFs. Don't use one version with one form and another with another. Use clear and concise questions, prompts, and instructions. And use the option of circling answers is probably not a good idea. Instead, check boxes are probably going to get you more accurate information. As I said, boxes or separate lines to hold the answers. Again, this helps to inform the person that's recording it or providing you the information. And I'll give you an example here in a bit. Separate the columns with thick lines. Provide bold and italicized instructions so it stands out separately so people know what they're looking at and reading. Minimize those free text responses and avoid collection of derived data to decrease calculations errors. And an example of a derived data would be asking for the person that's capturing the data to calculate a BMI, and so they're going to use that using their height and weight and age. If it's probably better for you just to collect the height, weight, and age yourself, and then calculate the information yourself. If you're relying totally on that person that's capturing the data to calculate that BMI, you may come back with some erroneous information. So this is a suggestion. Avoid using check all that apply, because it then it really forces that person to make assumptions. Specify the unit of measure. And I'll show you again an example of what is a good case report for and what's maybe not so good. Indicate the number of decimal places you want recorded. Standard data format, for example, for your year or date of birth is DDMMYYY, very commonly used. And use pre-coded answer sets whenever possible. This really helps with statistical analysis, but it also makes it much easier for the data to be collected. So simply yes, no, male, female, and for if you're going to have grading or levels of information you're trying to capture, make that consistent. So for like adverse events, it's they're going to choose between mild, moderate, or severe. Again, consider using common data elements. NCI has done a lot of work on building a repository or like we often call it a warehouse of commonly used common data elements that we really strongly suggest our research program people to use and investigators as they present trials for us to reevaluate. We want to see common data elements across them. We also really encourage, if it's specifically a new forum, to use to consider piloting the forums amongst a few of your outlying sites or research staff to see do they make sense, are they bringing home the information that you're interested in, or are you missing the boat? And then complete that CRF development prior to study activation. It's really important. It's nothing more frustrating for staff to have a study they're anxious to start with, but they're still waiting on your CRF forms. And those CRF forms also help to inform the research site to know how complex and detailed this study is going to be and help them to decide what kind of staffing to address towards that trial. There are examples, again, of poorly designed CRFs, poorly designed studies usually. They're not asking for the data that you really want to have collected. It might require modification down the line or down the road after the study's activated, which adds difficulty and complexity to the analysis process. It actually impedes the process. It requires reviewing and cleaning the data through the process of analysis. It might lead to you actually missing target dates that you need, which would really inform your endpoints possibly. And again, if you're collecting too much data, you're really wasting the resources of the collection and processing. And you know, any kind of delay in getting that accomplished, you're actually delaying the ability to get the answers that you want in your study. So here's a simple to the left is an example of a poorly designed CRF where there are just you're asking for the information, but then there's just a simple line that you're expecting everyone to understand what numbers and what data you want. Whereas on the right, the well-designed, there's actually boxes being provided for them to fill in, followed by an explanation of what those boxes should be. So example for your date of visit, it's the day, in this case, it's the day, first, month, and year. Blood pressure is the millimeters per mercury, pulse beats per minute. That's clear for anyone who's going to be filling out that form, so you're going to get consistent information back, whereas the example on the left, you may get all kinds of information back that you're not going to be able to use, or you're going to have to query the sites and get more information for them, and that's just going to frustrate everyone. So to talk a little bit about electronic CRFs, this is a mode that I think more and more sponsors and researchers are going to. And there are many commercial programs out there. I've only listed a few here. There are many more than this. Oracle, Clinitrial, Rave, eClinical, they all kind of have similar names but different. And the advantages of electronic data capture are it actually is a much faster mode. A research person or a CRA can sit at the computer and enter the data, and it's electronically submitted fairly quickly. It actually, I think, promotes cleaner data collection because oftentimes they're programmed to query or question immediately erroneous information. If they submit a number that's way out of range for what they're expecting, it'll query the person immediately and say, did you put that in right? Or maybe they just transcribed it incorrectly. It's easier for monitors and monitoring, auditing, because the information is more clear. You don't have handwritten type things. It's a central database for storage for all trial data. It makes it much easier for statistical analysis. And again, oftentimes allows for real-time data access by the sponsors themselves. There are some drawbacks to it, though. There's lack of on-site technology. I think this is improving, but I still see it, particularly in some of our community-based programs, if they're in institutions that their computer IT systems are not quite up to the level that they need to be to adopt or to adapt to the electronic forms that are coming or the system that's being used. There is a high cost to investment initially for sponsors to develop these electronic CRFs. These companies are out to make money. That's part of why they're in the business. So it can be quite expensive. There is this also a complexity of the installation and maintenance of the software that goes along with the cost. And then sometimes investigators they're not terribly motivated. There's a lot of training that needs to be done. So here's an example of maybe what a web view of a form may look like. It looks pretty simple. These little boxes seem like they're pretty simple to fill in, and they actually are. This is actually a fairly good example of what a CRF should look like. But there's a lot of work that goes on behind building this. All of these little boxes have to be pre-filled, usually with an Excel spreadsheet behind the scenes, and this is where you need your programmers and the people on board to help you design that. I've been involved in some of this, and I'm amazed by the complexity of it behind the scenes work. I'm really happy someone else does that and not me, but you have to think about it. There is more behind it, and this is where the common data elements comes in, that if you use that warehouse, you can just pull that information into this type of thing. Makes it much easier for you. So just a few things to think about. So again, designing the electronic CRF is very similar to paper. The method of data collection will again impact the design of how those data entry screens will look. The same considerations for designing these forms should be the same as what you've done for paper forms. Again, consider the volume and the frequency of the data that you're collecting. Avoid excess detail on the screens. And really important to thoroughly test these out. We've had a few occurrences where a study's been opened and activated, and there is some glitch within the electronic data forms, and sites can't use it. And so we have to get that fixed quickly, or else put the study on hold a bit until we can get it fixed. Again, I think many of these and many of our researchers have developed user instructions for these. I think they are vital. So choosing electronic data systems, you think about its scope, its scalability, how is it going to be used over the long term? Does it have the ability to adapt and change? Is it have interoperability between other systems? How secure is it? Does it have an underlying structure that built well enough? And is it user-friendly? The Code of Federal Regulations also does address electronic records as well as signatures, reading these codes is important for anyone who's wanting to consider developing these, but they basically require various mechanisms to be employed, such as ensuring that the data is accurate, reliable, and has not been altered. Does the system allow you to check for that? Can you create accurate and complete copies of the records? Went for an inspection or review. Are the records protected and retrievable when necessary? And then is there the ability to limit access to the system, usually by usernames and passwords, so not everyone can access it. Another more on the Code of Federal Regulations. Can they readily identify who has entered the information? Can that be tracked? And has that data been modified or changed across the time? This is again trying to assess for not necessarily fraud, but changes. I mean, I think it's important in the studies to be able to track that. Monitors and auditors will be interested in it. It needs to hold individuals accountable and responsible for the data under an electronic signature, and that in itself is, I found through experience with some of our research sites, various programs, various electronic systems that sites have, some have the ability to provide electronic signatures and others don't. And they also have to be certified programs, so check into that when you're considering developing these and considering your research site selection. Do they have that capability? And again, training. That's why you're all here today, is training. So it just seems to be an ongoing with clinical research. So actual data transfer, paper CRFs are usually completed at the site. They're submitted to the sponsor, and then they're electronically entered by the sponsor at their site. So it's kind of a lot of extra work and expense. Electronic, again, they can log in and actually enter the data directly at the site, and it allows for real-time data review. There are other methods or things that are collected, though, and again, it might be more related to patient-reported outcomes or patient-reported forms where the patients fill out things on paper and then they're sent in or transcribed into an electronic system, and those might include your patient diaries, any calendars that they might complete, questionnaires, quality of life type forms, and any data supporting source documents.